Mesenchymal hamartoma of the liver and the DICER1 syndrome. Definition. Mesenchymal hamartoma of the liver, MHA, is a benign tumor affecting children that is characterized by a primitive myxoid stroma with cystically delayed bile ducts. Alterations involving chromosome 19 are a recurrent underlying cause of MHL. This alteration activates the chromosome 19 microRNA cluster.
Hamartomas are benign, localized, tumor-like masses that are not true neoplasms. They are composed of two or more tissue types that are normally found at that site, and the tissue mass is non-functioning and disorganized. This is an example of a breast hamartoma. These lesions are sometimes picked up on breast screening and are composed of a fibrous stroma containing lobular and ductal structures. Another common example of a hamartoma is the coin lesion found in the lung, otherwise known as an adenochondroma because it is composed predominantly of cartilage and bronchial epithelium. These are often an incidental finding on chest X-rays. And here we can see the gross appearance of an adenochondroma or hamartoma. Hamartomas are developmental abnormalities, and they are clinically important because they may be associated with clinical syndromes. One example is tuberous sclerosis, and another is Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. This is an example of a Peutz-Jeghers polyp. And this is the histological appearance of a Peutz-Jeghers polyp with disorganized glands lying in a stroma composed predominantly of smooth muscle.
DICER syndrome is a tumor predisposition syndrome that features several dysontogenic system conditions in young children, most notably pleuropulmonary blastoma and cystic nephroma. Multinodular goiter is the most frequent clinical manifestation. This report studied the possibility that MHL is a phenotype of DICER1 syndrome. Applications in medicine. Case report. A 26-month-old boy present with a cyst in the left hepatic lobe. He must was resected, but 4 months later, because of multiple recurrent enlarging cysts, a hepatic lobectomy was performed, which revealed multiple cysts. Anatomopathological findings led to a diagnosis of MHL.
This.
Pros and cons. Pros: hamartomas are in cancer, and second, they can appear or invade other parts of the body. And the cons: they can be dangerous if they press on important organs that are around them. And second, they can produce heart failure due to an arteriovenous shunt.
A hamartoma in general is a term used to describe the benign lesion, which is more likely a developmental malformation than the true neoplasia. And this also very likely applies for fibrous hamartoma of infancy. It affects very small children, usually younger than 2 years of age. It presents as rapidly growing mass in the subcutaneous area. It can be found in the axillary region, inguinal region in the trunk, or in the upper arms, and hands and feet are usually not affected. Microscopically, we typically see three components: the adipose tissue, fibrous tissue, and immature mesenchymal cells. The adipose tissue is composed of uniform, bland, normal-looking adipocytes. Fibrous component is arranged in the fascicles, and it is composed of collagen fibers and bland spindle-shaped fibroblasts. And here we have the third component, which is composed of immature mesenchymal cells arranged in sheets. And these cells typically have spindle-shaped nuclei or oval-shaped nuclei, sometimes also stellate-shaped nuclei. And we typically see basophilic background if you compare this fibromatous or fibrous component with collagen fibers. Those are slightly more eosinophilic. Here we have these mesenchymal cells with a basophilic appearance of the background. Here we have some small blood vessels and capillaries. Now this is another area. So again, here we have adipose tissue, fibrous component, arranged in these fascicles, and multiple areas of immature mesenchymal cells. And also here we can find some blood vessels and small capillaries. Fibrous hamartoma of the infancy is rapidly growing mass. However, it has good prognosis, it is benign, and complete surgical excision is usually curative. Thanks for watching.
Hamartomas are rare in Ecuador, and 80% are detected in childhood. Predominate in the male sex, often manifests clinically before 3 years of age, with a maximum between 18 and 98 months. Preferably located in the right lobe, 75%. The results of the liver function are normal in most cases. And the conclusion: MHL may be associated with both germline and somatic mutation in the DICER1 syndrome in the absence of chromosomal translocation involving 19q13 or aberrant activation of C19MC microRNAs.
The most common types of benign liver tumors include hemangiomas, which are more of an abnormal nest of blood vessels in the liver, focal nodular hyperplasia, which is a term that refers to areas in the liver which grow essentially larger and quicker than other areas of the liver, and finally adenomas, or abnormal growths of liver cells, which are technically still benign. The causes of benign liver tumors are in large part unknown, particularly when it comes to hemangiomas and focal nodular hyperplasia. Some of these types of diseases can run in families. However, for the most part, we don't know what truly causes them. Adenomas may be one exception. For patients who experience an adenoma, oftentimes that's from an excess in estrogen levels. It's more common historically when the estrogen in women's contraceptives were higher. Nevertheless, we still do see it occasionally today associated with oral contraceptive use. By and large, benign liver tumors are watched, meaning we don't do any specific therapy for them. We don't give medications or offer surgeries for them. The one exception is perhaps when tumors cause discomfort or pain. In those cases, we will sometimes offer patients interventions, including medications and potentially surgeries. However, we're careful to evaluate these patients, as it is rare for a benign liver tumor to cause pain or discomfort. The one exception is perhaps a hepatic adenoma. When hepatic adenomas enlarge to a certain size, they become at risk for bleeding and for development of malignancy. So in those cases, we can occasionally offer a resection. The difference between a benign liver tumor and a malignant liver tumor is the ability of the cells that make up that tumor to spread elsewhere in the body and cause harm. For a benign liver tumor, these are things which usually do not grow quickly, and they do not leave the liver and colonize other areas of the body and cause harm. Cancer, on the other hand, can. Cancer invades the normal tissues, spreads throughout the liver, and can go elsewhere in the body, and ultimately can unfortunately take a patient's life. Well, for the most part, benign liver tumors do not need any specific therapies, and as we discussed a little earlier, we mostly will watch these. Malignant liver tumors, however, do routinely require therapy. That therapy is usually driven by a multidisciplinary discussion where we discuss and decide on the utilization of both medical, surgical, and interventional radiologic interventions to try to prevent this tumor from growing, spreading, and taking a patient's life.
Thanks for watching.